Basically, il deal with a very important and branding institution of science, Anonymous Peer Review. What is peer review? It is the trial through which you will be granted or denied the privilege to become a member of the scientific community. How? By publishing or by not publishing your papers in a scientific journal. Peer review now is anonymous. Why is it anonymous? Just because journals would like to allow reviewers to speak in a frank and candid way. Anonymity is a kind of protection and there should be also a guarantee of objectivity. Is that a good solution? Well, maybe, but it involves some complicated questions, both philosophical and social. Why? Because to build sound science, we need to build also a balance between social accountability and moral autonomy. My very first chunk of my lesson will deal with a little chunk, but a very little, of philosophy. I will start with a reflection made by Julie Zhu. No, Julie Zhu is not a theoretical philosopher, as we'll see, about a mythical ring. The tale of the Ring of Gyges is told in the second book of the Republic, written by Plato. The Ring of Gyges is a magical ring who has the property to give its owner the power of invisibility. According to Julie Zhu's readings of Plato, the tale is meant to explain that if everyone of us wore the Ring of Gyges, me, I, you, everyone of us will behave like a criminal. Why? According to Julie Zhu, because morality comes from full disclosure. Morality needs social accountability. Now, let's see who is Julie Zhu. She's not a philosopher, maybe she's an applied and, alas, corporate political philosophy. As you see, she's working for Facebook. Julie Zhu accountability is a kind of social but also corporate accountability. Is Julie Zhu's reading of Plato accurate? Well, not at all, because the tale of the Ring of Gyges was presented, was proposed to Socrates in the second book of the Republic as a challenge. And the challenge was to formulate a theory of justice so strong that will make us behave in a moral way even outside the eye of the public, even while wearing the Ring of Gyges. As we can see, Zhu's Facebook and Plato's concerns are very different. According to Plato, morality is autonomy and moral responsibility. I behave in a moral way when I am able to choose in a free way how to behave according to Facebook. Morality is a different question. It is a question of accountability. I am a moral person if only if I am under the eye of a public or under the eye of a corporate representation of the public like Facebook. So Plato's challenge was very difficult because the goal of Plato was the aim of reducing the scope of formal and informal law or social control and to widen the scope of ethics, of autonomous behavior. Maybe you are asking yourself why she started with Plato. Well, the Republic of Plato deals with a lot of topics, but one topic is the most interesting for us. It is the topic of a question of a constitution of a scientific community. If you remember something of your previous career, you should remember also that Plato's in the Republic theorizes the idea of philosophers, scientists, rulers. So, from my very limited point of view, to deal with the Republic in this limited scope is also asking yourself questions about the constitution of a scientific community and asking ourselves also a question about the social means to give society at large a set of checked beliefs, a question of moral autonomy, of autonomy of science on the other hand, and on accountability of science on the one hand. So, we will analyze, we will scrutinize the question of the review by bearing in mind a crucial question. Who or what is wearing in the scientific community the ring of judges? We will not deal with the Middle Ages, but we have to start with the Middle Ages. During the Middle Ages, scientific research used to be secret. So, in the Middle Ages, every research was, as it were, a bearer of the ring of judges. In the modern age, science struggled and won, not in Italy, but for instance in the UK, to become public, to become autonomous. So the wearer of the ring of judges was, I shall explain it later, the scientific community as a whole. In the contemporary age, is the age of anonymous peer review, of evaluation of research by means of bibliometrics, the counting of citation, algorithms, and so on. The wearers of the review types are anonymous referee, journal editors, and in a seemingly impersonal way, also algorithms and lords of metadata, corporation who owns the data about the citation. I will explain in a better way later. Well, let's start from the age of the print, the age of print, the early modern age. You can see here a flow chart of the publishing processes. As you can see, there is an obvious bottleneck, the very printing press. It is economically and technologically impossible to print every paper we receive. So we have to select the papers by means of some way. And the way was peer review. Is there a kind of technological necessity? Well, we shall see. Now, let's sketch a possible flow. In the JustPrint, we need to filter and then publish. So we can imagine that from this situation, closed peer review follows. On the other hand, in the internet age, publishing became something trivial, so we can imagine that the flow publish then filter connected to a peer review that is open because it's made by users, by commenters and so on, could be a natural, obvious solution. Well, it is not the case. It is not the case because the early peer review was not closed, but was open. You can see the very first scientific journal, the Philosophical Transactions of the Royal Society, which was founded in 1665. Well, the process of publication was the following. A member of the Royal Society or a person external to the Society would present a report of his experiment. Such a report was given to a couple of members of the Royal Society who had the task to peruse it. Peruse means to give it a very accurate and careful reading. After that, the discovery was registered in a register that was not public because it was the register held to guarantee the paternity of the discoveries themselves, and the publication was the very last step of the flow. But between the perusal and the publication, there was a huge and lively and sometimes excruciating debate, because this reading regime was meant to generate debates, to generate public debates within the Royal Society, but it was not meant to conceal science. It was meant to make science public, but to make science public and to make it public in a civil and controlled way. It was a kind of a common ground for peers, gentlemen scientists, to have their debate without fighting, in a civil and educated way. It was a civil way to manage the disagreements, but disagreements were fought as fault for fault. Peer review in the form of today was invented later in 1831. William Weaver proposed that in another journal, the Proceedings of the Royal Society, it was a journal about the main journal, the Philosophical Transactions of the Royal Society, two eminent scholars offered some report about the paper Peter's letter have been published in the Philosophical Transactions of the Royal Society. Why? Not by with the aim to brand the papers, but with the aim to give science more publicity. Well, after 2 years, this peer review became anonymous. Why? Because it caused a lot of fightings, not only between reviewers and authors, not only among reviewers and authors, but also among the reviewers themselves. But it became very important only in the second half of the 20th century. Why? Because in the second half of the 20th century, science became a business and an industrialized enterprise. Scientists feel the need to appear accountability, to appear accountable before the public, under the eyes of the public, but they do not want to lose their autonomy. So, they represent anonymous peer review as a kind of brand of objectivity, of mechanical objectivity, the objectivity that we attain by following some well-defined rules, an objectivity that can be understood also by a layman. So, anonymous peer review was a guarantee of objectivity, of impartiality, and it is connected to a science that is it has become a social and industrial enterprise that is funded by the taxpayers and feel the need to justify itself without losing its autonomy. In the second half of the 20th century, journals in such a situation in which science and the money spent for science need to be justified before the eye of the public, before the eye of the government, before the eye of the so-called taxpayer, journals became also proxies for the scholarly community. How? Well, to understand whether a scientist is good or not is very difficult for a layman. To understand whether a procedure has been followed or not is easier. So, if we contrive a clear procedure of evaluation and of selection, we can appear a good scientist before the eye of the public and before the eye of administrators who decide about our career in a very easy way. In this perspective, when I am a good researcher, this is the regime of publish or perish. It is something that every one of you knows. Alas very well. I am a good researcher when my papers are published in good peer-reviewed scholarly journals, because being selected through an anonymous peer review is a guarantee of the objectivity of a scientific choice. Or, if I work in the fields of humanities, my monographs are published by a publisher of good reputation. What is a good scholarly journal? Well, we have, in the second half of the 20th century, we found a way to establish it without the need of reading the paper, to establish it also before the eye of the lineman. A good scholarly journal is a journal that has a high impact factor. What is impact factor? It is a ratio. A ratio that is made by the number of citations that the article published in a journal received during a given year, to the total amount of articles that have been published in the very same journals during the previous 2 years. It is an index of popularity and of popularity of the journal. Maybe you know that Nature itself some weeks ago has deprecated the impact factor. Why? Well, just because it is not very accurate. It measures the popularity of the journal, but it does not say anything about the individual articles. As you probably know, citations follow a power law. So about 80% of the article, even in a top journal, do not get cited, not get cited at all. Well, let's continue our explanation, Weaver. What is an excellent researcher? An excellent researcher is a researcher who has a high number of citations in good scholarly journal. How can we calculate the number of citations? Well, by means on the basis of a closed and a proprietary database. Scopus, it is owned by Elsevier, one of the most powerful oligopolists of scientific publishing. And Clarivate Analytics. What is Clarivate Analytics? It is just the last name of of the Institute of Scientific Information that was founded by Garfield, a very clever scientist entrepreneur. But it was the business was so rich that it was and it is sold periodically. The very last proprietors is an investment speculative investment fund that is based in Asia, and now its name is Clarivate Analytics. So, however, my point is that bibliometrics is calculated on databases that are closed, not public, and proprietary. Therefore, we have to pay to get them, and every academic library must subscribe to them and to the journals they include. Why? Because they are very important for the career of every researcher, and then consequently publisher may raise the subscription prices ad libitum. This chart is well known by every librarian. It is a chart that represents the so-called serial prices crisis. The subscription prices of a scholarly journal has been increasing at a rate faster than inflation, much faster than inflation, about 300% more above inflation for several decades. Is that capitalism? Is that a normal situation? Well, it is not. It is a kind of feudalism. Why? Well, the academic publisher get articles, be reviewed with much of editing for free, but researchers and the university libraries must buy a lot of money, of taxpayers, of students' money, by the publisher to get their own work back. Or, in different model, founders or authors must pay to get their work published. Do you know the meaning of APC? It means article processing charges. You could choose to make your article accessible to the public even in a subscription journal, but the publisher will ask you to pay something, 1,000, 2,000 euros, counting as APC. So APC is rather scary. Why do we pay publisher? Just to get a symbolic reward, a self-styled brand of excellence that is not so symbolic as in most evaluation, most system of search assessment, research evaluation, such brand of excellence is also the passport for your academic career. So, the situation in which we have to work and to do our research is rather sad, because science that in the early modern age struggled to become public, to become open, now is privatized. It is privatized in the meaning that a lot of choices about evaluation of research, about peer review, about dissemination itself, is concentrated in the hands of very few people. Is it possible to make science a little more open? Well, nature itself, one of the most important top journals in the field of natural science, tried some years ago an experiment in open peer review. They exposed some published article to the comment of the public. And I am sad to tell you that what this experiment was not very successful. Was not very successful because only a small proportion of authors opted to participate, and most researchers were not very willing to offer their comments. Why? Well, we all can understand why. Why should they do it? If we work in a publish or perish system, to participate in a public debate is a waste of time. You should work to write papers to submit to top journal. And it's also dangerous, because during the open debate you could criticize by accident, by chance, also one of your potential anonymous peer reviewer. And as everyone knows, under the shroud of anonymity, the reviewer could think that it's easy to have his revenge on your possible criticism. However, some scholars are trying to open science. I shall present you some example. The first one of them is Timothy Gowers. Timothy Gowers is a mathematician. He's a field medalist. The field medal in the field of mathematics is like the Nobel Prize. Is waging a personal war war against Elsevier. Maybe you know his blog that is called The Cost of Knowledge, and his goal is to reduce the cost of knowledge and to break free from commercial publisher. Another hero of open science is a very young biophysicist, Michel Bohn. I know you. This is a quote from an article of Michel Bohn himself. Michel Bohn would like to rebuild a science more transparent, more open, and more communal and democratic. And the very last, but not least, of these open science heroes is a media scholar, Kathleen Fitzpatrick. Kathleen Fitzpatrick would like to break free from the so-called Academy of Undead. I will explain later what it means. And to make humanities more connected in a way more human. Let's scrutinize these three experiments one by one. Timothy Gowers founded an overlay journal, discrete analysis. What is an overlay journal? As maybe you know, the physicist, as of 1991, founded a public repository of their papers, the so-called archive. Why? And they use it in a very high rate. Why do they found it? Do they found this archive? Why do they use it? Because they need to share the result of their research in a very fast way, and they do not want to wait for the biblical or geological time through which journals make their publishing decisions. So, in the world of the physicist, the publication in a top journal is just for the career, for the science, for debate, for sharing. That is the archive. But what the overlay journal of Timothy Gowers does not publish any new article. It just selects articles and reviews articles that have been uploaded and made public by the archive. It recommends it to the readers. Why does it do it? To give authors the opportunity to publish in a peer-reviewed journal, to receive a brand of scientifici, while without paying any publisher, without paying in a direct or indirect way any publisher. It is a means to bypass the need to deal with a commercial publisher. Gowers has some long-term goals promoting the use of open repositories of the prints, like Archive, but also like Zinodo.org, like SOC Archive, that is an archive for social science, and as I think that most of you are engineers, there is also a new archive for engineering that is called INGR Archive. The second long-term goal is opening the whole scientific process of discovery and debate. Publication is something trivial. The question is to select, to judge, to evaluate the articles, but We as scholars or scientists can do it without in an open way and without the need to deal with a commercial publisher and to leave closed access subscription journal and commercial publisher behind. The Research Journal of Science is has been founded by Michel Bon. It is more than an archive and better than a journal because it is a system that is made of an open archive, but in such a system you can all the subscribers and you can subscribe to it, you can subscribe to it only if you have an institutional email address like Polito, IT, UNITO, IT, and the like. Every members of the archive of the Self Journal of Science can provide his or her peer review, and it has also some incentive to be encouraged. It is encouraged to do it. Why? Because giving an accurate and careful review makes you visible and make more likely that readers would read your article, articles themselves. And it provides also a distributed overlay collection. You can recommend an article, you can give a vote to an article. And here is an example. As you can see, you have the possibility to vote for the article, you have the possibility to recommend it, and you can see all a lot of download statistics and so forth. The last example, the last experiment, is the experiment of Karine Fitzpatrick. This is a WordPress blog, but this WordPress blog works with a WordPress plugin that has been developed by the Institute of the Future of a Book. The plugin is Comment Press, and make it possible to add a comment in a very granular way, to divide an article into chunks and to add comments chunk by chunk. Why is Kathleen Fitzpatrick trying such an experiment? Well, because in the field of humanities, traditional peer review hinders the circulation of ideas, as the conversation between authors and reviewers is not public, and excludes, therefore, authors and the public on the conversation of science. On the other hand, post-publication open peer review guarantees transparency, acknowledges a reviewer, and connects authors. Does it work? Well, for Kathleen Fitzpatrick, it worked very well because she was able to gather around her a very lively and collaborative community of knowledge. Her book was published by New York University Press through a traditional peer review. It got also a book review on the New York Times, but At the same time, it was submitted to an open peer review through Comment Press. You can see here the technological means of this such open peer review, and the book with all the reviews and the conversation among reviewers and between authors and between Kathleen Fitzpatrick herself and the other reviewers can be seen on the internet. And it is such a library product, is more interesting and richer than the book, the traditional book, because it is in a way enhanced, augmented by the comments and the criticism of a lot of people. But Kathleen Fitzpatrick could do it because it could count on a very collaborative community of knowledge. So, you are asking yourself. No? Mm-hmm. Test, yes, it works. It keeps on working. You are asking yourself, well, open peer review is wonderful, but maybe it's just for angelical intellects. Why? Well, because academic intellects are assessed as an individual authors, not as a member of a community of knowledge or a member of a community of discussion, are evaluated in the perspective of their product, their products, their paper, their write, not of their processes, the ability to be an important and collaborative member of a debate or a conversation, and above all, they fear responsibility. They are afraid to comment the works of other colleagues in a public, transparent way. Anonymity, as it were, is a very comfortable solution. I'm citing here a computer scientist, Bertrand Meyer. I owe this citation to a suggestion of Enrico Nardelli on the next center mining list, who uses to sign his reviews, his referee reports for a traditional journal that ask him in his report. Why does he do it? Well, because he thinks that anonymity just encourages power games, backstabbing, and worst of all, poor quality. If I am under the protection of anonymity, I have no incentive to give an accurate review. My work will be careless, will be shoddy. So, even if in some case anonymity could be justified, in general, according to Bertrand Meyer, it is not the case. The advantages of an open peer review, the accountability of an open peer review, are far greater, larger than the disadvantages. Why such a outlandish behavior is important and it is worth mentioning. Well, because contemporary science is living a deep crisis. A deep crisis that is due to the very system of research evaluation. Scientist Richard Horton is the editor of The Lancet. The Lancet is an Elsevier journal, but it's also one of the most important journal in the field of medical sciences. And according to him, science has taken a turn toward darkness. Why? As I need to publish some certain journal to be cited to have an academic career, the easy way to do it is to write articles that are so sexy that they can lure editors and reviewers to accept it for publication. I am encouraged to follow the fashion, to follow the mainstream trend. I am not encouraged to represent, to describe my research in an honest and serious way. Much of scientific literature, perhaps half, might simply be untrue. They are not, these words are not mine, are not the point of view of a scholar in the field of humanities that is rather odd and outlandish. It is a point of view of the editor of The Lancet himself. What is the root of such a situation? Well, who is responsible? Who is accountable in such a publishing and evaluating system? If you think about it, you discover that responsibility is on the shoulder of persons that are protected by anonymity, persons that are not accountable before the eye of a fellow a scientist of a very sane scientific community. And responsibility stays only in impersonal proprietary bibliometric algorithms. So there are no one in such a system has the gut to tell this article is good, this article is bad, but it is told only in a very protected, secret way, and is told by algorithms. It is easy to judge the works of a college in such a way, but it is also a way to avoid responsibility. And in such a system, it is also obvious and consequential that researchers themselves are encouraged to behave in an irresponsible way. I have to write so that I can get a lot of citation, so that I can seduce editors and reviewers. The question of the value of a seriousness of my research is a secondary question. So, such a situation is a situation that generates a kind of bibliometric fetishism. Fetishism is the belief that some object has some magical property. The bibliometric fetishism is the belief that an article published in a top journal and highly cited as a magical property of being also, for this only reason, sound science. Mario Biagioli wrote on Nature that in such a situation the only rule of the game is gaming the rules. Why? Well, there is a law of economics, it's called the Goddard law, according to which when a feature of an economy is picked as an indicator of the economy itself, then stops to function well as an indicator. Why? Because social sciences are reflective, because if I know that the number of citations is crucial for my career, what would I do? Well, I would work to enhance, to increase the number of citations by using every kind of trick. Citations used to be the money of sciences, of science, the way by which scientists pay their debts to the college. But when citations become also indices for evaluation of science, they stop immediately to be the money of science. They become goals, aims that should be attained at every, with every way, at every cost. Some examples I do not stay too much on this. A lot of tricks to get published and to enhance, to raise the number of our publication, to make your work sexier and to lure journals into publishing it. For instance, Alan Slicing is simply a practice to cut our work in a collection of minimum publishable units so that to produce so that we can produce a lot of articles, more about the a single topics, but the number of articles and the number of citations increases. It is not good for the sake of the understanding of my work, because one topic is sliced in a lot of subtopics, but it's very useful for my career. So, is where a way out? Well, maybe you know Retraction Watch. It is a blog, and it is a blog who provides news about the so-called retraction. What are the retractions? Are the unpublishing of published article. Why? Because some scholar, different from the anonymous peer reviewers, finds out that those articles are in some way fraud. Well, the number of published papers in the science rose by about 40% in the years between 2000 and 2010. But the number of the transactions grew tenfold. Why? Well, because of that, this situation, because of this fetishism, of this emphasis on the need to publish a lot of articles for academic careers, and because of the very good heart law. According to the maintainer of Retractation Watch, the published paper should not be considered as a sacred object. What is science? Well, science should be all that happens after being published. Why? Because the very number and the very increase of a number of the retractions shows that a post-publication and open peer review is not just an accessory operation. It is a need in the very enterprise of science, and it would be easier to judge and to discuss about the articles that are published if we de-emphasized the very idea of a scientific publication. How? By rewarding data sharing, post-publication peer review, the willingness to take part to a scientific debate about the soundness of our research, and so on. The emphasizing published article would mean to find a kind of therapy for the illness of bibliometric fetishism, as it were. Now, my last topic is just an intellectual provocation, a rather disruptive intellectual provocation. Why I present you such a provocation? Because if you remember the beginning of my conference, I presented you two kinds of responsibility: a social accountability, the disclosure of ourselves under the eye of the public, and I associated it with Julie Zhu, with Alas Facebook, but I spoke also about a moral responsibility, the responsibility of a person who is wearing the legal judges, and in spite of his or her invisibility, is able to reflect on his behavior, to reflect on his choices, and to reach autonomous decision. I have spoken about open peer review as a means of accountability, a la Julie Zhu, but I have neglected the other side of the question, the problem of autonomy, of moral autonomy of a researcher, of a scientist, the freedom to choose the topic of your research without depending on the wishes, the interests, the fashions, the trends, the mainstream. This subversive project from India is useful to deal with the other side of responsibility, the moral responsibility of an autonomous researcher. The idea of this anonymous Indian scholar is very simple. To solve the crisis of science, the crisis that has been described by Richard Horton, for instance, we have to flip the requirements of anonymity by disclosing the hidden and concealing the visible. Is it there or there? Because it is an anonymous he is an anonymous or she, it's an anonymous person. The idea is anonymizing published papers to limit their quantity and to enhance their quality. If I am sure that my paper would remain anonymous, for instance, for 20 years or for 70 years after my death, like this is the term of expiration of intellectual property rights, what would I write? I would write papers for the sake of my career. I would write papers if and only if I think to have something to tell to everyone that is important for the sake of it. So I would write a few I will write fewer papers, but I will write papers made for the humanities, as it were, and not made for mankind as a whole, and not made for my individual academic career. On the other hand, according to this anonymous, we should sign our referee reports to make reviewers responsible and to recognize their work. We should leave in the curation the selection of articles to recognize to other nominative, to make curators responsible and to acknowledge their work in a situation in which publishing is trivial because we do it very easily and cheaply on the internet. The work of a curator is very important because he or she selects articles that are worth reading among a high number of papers. And by evaluating research only by their words and deeds and not by their papers. What does it mean, evaluating research by their words and deeds? Well, by their teaching and mentoring ability. A researcher is a person who is able to reproduce other scientists, to lead young scholars and so on by their reviewing and curation works and also by personal interview, by conversation. So in such a situation researchers as authors would be autonomous in the meaning of Plato. Morally autonomous, would wear the legal charges, would be free to choose the topic of their research, and would be free to choose also topics that are not mainstream, that are not so sexy for being published in a top journal, and so on. Researcher would wear ring of judges. On the other hand, researchers as evaluators and discussers would be accountable in the meaning of the accountability on the eye of the public. It is just a provocation, but I would like you to ask yourself if you had the opportunity to have any your judges as authors, would you then writing all that you are writing now? No, and as a conclusion, as a way to reach the conclusion, I offer two inconclusive citations. The first citation is a citation made by my anonymous. It is a distant citation. It is an outlandish citation about disinterestedness. But the second citation is a Western citation. It is a citation from Wissenschaftliches Beruf, Science as a Vocation, written about 1 century ago by Max Weber. As you can see, the second Western citation is telling, is communicating the very same concept of the first Atlantic and Eastern citation, that when we serve science, we must be willing to treat our papers, our work, just as a step on a ladder. On a ladder that is longer and more important than our personal work. According to David Weinberger, it is he used to be a philosopher, now it is a kind of philosopher of the internet. The internet and the practice of using the internet for doing open science could be confusing for the layman. Why? Because the layman was accustomed to the idea that science was a collection of true beliefs. If a layman is exposed to the debate, a scientific debate, an open scientific debate on the net, he or she could receive the impression of a mess, not a set of true beliefs, but a mess. A mess in which it's very difficult to understand who is wrong and who is right. But such a representation of science is a science as is seen, is and was seen by scientists themselves. The layman in the age of the printing press received the impression of science as a set of true beliefs because he was not a scientist, he was just a believer. The net, the internet, if we bypass top journals, commercial, scientific rubrics, and so on, will give to everyone a more accurate representation of science. Science is not a collection of belief, it is faith, not science. It is, on the other hand, a practice of debate, of proof, of demonstration, a never-ending conversation. Now, the real conclusion are a request of comment, the true conclusion, and a call, an invitation to answer to a call for papers, but after proposing my request for comments and my our call for papers, I would like to explain why my lesson has been a collection of citations. The reason of such a way of exposing ideas is twofold. The first one is to show it is rhetorical, to show you that such ideas can appear, can seem outlandish, odd, but they are not. They are shared by a lot of scholars, more important, more prestigious, more famous than I am. And the second one is a moral choice. I would like you to understand that my ideas are not important because they are my ideas, but because they are ideas shared and according to my opinion worth discussing. So, to use a lot of citation of quote from other people is a way to remain behind the ideas and not in front of them. If I am alone, I propose you another citation in Italiano di Norisi, used to say to Nanni Moretti and his movies, films, to me, spostati Nanni che devo vedere il film, because the ego of Nanni Moretti was according to him so overwhelming that it invades the very films made by Nanni Moretti himself. So, the request for comment and the request for comments and the call for papers. The request for comments is my curation of the article written by this anonymous from India. Your comments are welcome. And the second and the last call, my last call, is our call for papers. It is a call for papers of the Associazione Italiana per la Promozione della Scienza Aperta. If you would like to experiment the Self Journal of Science and Open Peer Review, you can try to answer to such a call for papers. Of course, we as scientific committee have a limited amount of money and a limited amount of time. So we can we'll be able to choose only for contributions. But such a way of proposing and discussing the contributions we received will give everyone the opportunity to be read, to be commented, and to get all the attention they deserve. On the other hand, our editorial choices that are forced because of lack of money and of lack of times will be transparent, because everyone will be able to see what we choose and what we do not choose. And not being chosen is not a brand of bad quality. It can be simply just a question of different interest. But giving everyone the opportunity to be read, to be published, to be commented, will allow us to reduce the racial rate of injustice that is connected to any editorial choice. So, this is a micro bibliography. Thank you very much for your attention. I hope that such an outlandish reflection could be useful in some period of your life. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you to Professor Pivato. We have a quarter of an hour for a discussion.
A couple of questions. First of all, thank you for your presentation. It was really interesting. And so at the outset, you presented the difference between Plato and Zuo position on the ring. I wanted to ask you if you think that Plato's position could be a realist position today.
Well, I think that to become a real position, to become a position that is a practice, we would need a kind of cultural turn, because the current system of evaluation of research gives us no way to change our culture. And as a rather old scholar, I am not in the position to recommend you to practice open science. I can recommend you to upload your papers on Zinodo before submitting them to journals on Zinodo.org, on Archive, on some other open repository. It is also guaranteed that reviewers on the Ringogizes do not steal your ideas under the cover of the anonymity, but I'm not in the position to recommend it to you. I am in the position to do it because I have done. I don't know how, but I have done my academic career. And I am able to recommend it to my colleagues that are full professors, because they have nothing to lose. They have done their career, they are in the position to try it. Many of them have academic and power interest, so many of them do not practice it. But someone, as you have seen, someone do. I am doing it myself, and do it myself, and I start. I began to do it when I was a researcher, a ricercatrice in the previous academic Italian regime, because I was tenured, and I told myself, well, we live only once. I would like to experiment something different. I would like to experiment through scientific discussion. And somehow, I had, in spite of this choice, I had an academic career that was successful. Now I am a former professor. I do not believe in it, but it's true. So the idea is that revolutions are difficult, and it is very difficult, almost impossible, to do a revolution with the protection of the police. So someone must try to do it, maybe not during my life, maybe in the future, as a lot of people are working for it, maybe it would be possible in culture. So my advice is to try to practice open science without damaging your career. Quindi try to publish in top journals and so on. But keep your mind open to the possibility of experiment something different, because we are living in, like Plato, we are living during an age of media revolution or digital revolution, as Juan Carlos de Martin is able to teach you. During the age of media revolution, it is also possible, it is not easy, but it is possible to experiment different kind of debate, different kinds of discussion, and so on. Galileo Galilei struggled to gain the autonomy of science, and as everyone of you know, he did not win, but the community of science as a whole did win. It was not easy, but revolutions are not easy. It is a dirty work, but someone has to do it. Not you now, but maybe if you are interested, if you would like to start or to be part of a revolution, maybe tomorrow or the day after tomorrow, when you grew older and accomplished, you can try to do something different.
Any other question or comment? If not, I will ask my own. Of course, I know Professor Vivato for many years now. And one comment that I would like to make is that you focus very much on the individual will and individual values and individual will, which of course is one essential part of the analysis. But I also thinking, looking back to now several years of interest in open access, also in free software and other issues. More and more I'm interested in the social dimension and also in the dimension of power. And in this regard, I found it illuminating, and while you were talking, I did some research on the fly about the fact that peer review becomes the norm after the Second World War, which means during the Cold War. And actually I did find some references about the fact that the shift to peer review, which is a complex history, goes back to the 19th century. I'm only identifying one additional cause of something much more complicated, was that actually the military influenced peer review, because they, especially in some fields like economics, because they wanted to give the appearance of total independence and objectivity to something which in reality was deeply influenced by military interests, at least in the US. And actually, if we think about it, the system of journals, editor-in-chiefs, associate editors, with their crucial power to appoint reviewers, is actually a very structured power system in which they can identify which topics should be favored or discouraged, which papers get published and when, because they are very, very opaque ways of delaying the publication, of creating obstacles for certain topics. And so I think it's important to also keep in mind that this dimension, which is really has influenced a lot and still influences a lot the scientific community, because if we don't also include this part, we place too much of a burden on the individual, which almost heroically, with this principle, even including your disclaimers about the fact that when you're young you cannot afford it, but still somehow places an heroic burden on the single individual of changing the whole system, which has strong determinants from the outside, and essentially economic and political power, to shape it in a certain way. So I don't want to become either too passive and saying we can do nothing until the revolution comes, but on the other hand, I also want to include it, because otherwise we do not understand why it's taking so long to change something which in principle should have changed, been changed easily in a couple of years when the internet came around.
Yes, I thought about the industrialized science. Industrialized science is a science that is connected to very strong economical, political, industrial, entrepreneurial interest. And this is a problem. This is a problem because the traditional review, the review of the Royal Society, was meant for a little community of crafter. Science was a kind of a craftsmanship. It was not an industry, it was a craftsmanship. One of the problems of peer reviews, of traditional peer review, is that...
Tra l'altro, c'è qualcuno che non parla italiano? Siamo tutti italiani? Ok, forse possiamo concederci tutti 5 minuti in italiano.
Allora dice uno dei problemi della revisione paritaria qual è? È che è stata appunto costruita per una comunità scientifica artigianale, quindi poche persone che si conoscevano fra loro, per le quali la pubblicazione era qualcosa di semplicemente notarile, perché le cose veramente importanti avevano luogo prima della pubblicazione. Infatti è stato detto che le pubblicazioni sono come i comunicati stampa che vengono emessi alla fine dei negoziati diplomatici. Poi sappiamo tutti che le cose importanti sono quelle che sono accadute durante i colloqui diplomatici. Il comunicato stampa è semplicemente per il pubblico. Allora, che cosa è successo? È successo che la scienza, per i motivi che ha espresso chiaramente lui, è diventata un'intrapresa industriale e tuttavia ha continuato a usare come sistema di selezione qualcosa che non era stato pensato per un'intrapresa industriale, per un'intrapresa artigianale e per scienziati che erano relativamente autonomi, perché chiaramente nessuno pensava nel XVII secolo che la rivoluzione copernicana sarebbe stata utile per i viaggi spaziali, diciamo così. Quindi erano relativamente autonomi perché facevano ricerca pura. Adesso, uno dei motivi della crisi della scienza è stato scoperto, è stato profetizzato da Max Weber in quella famosa conferenza che parla appunto della distinzione fra università tedesca basata sulla tradizione, quella americana industrializzata e burocratizzata. È stato riscoperto da un importante filosofo della scienza britannico, Jerome Ravitz, che scrisse un libro su questo addirittura nel 1971, e appunto questa sproporzione fra l'enormità, la dimensione degli interessi economici, industriali, imprenditoriali, politici che sono dietro la scienza industriale e gli strumenti che la scienza usa per controllare se stessi e se stessa, che sono appunto nel loro nucleo quelli della scienza artigianale, a cui si è aggiunta poi la bibliometria, che come sapete è una scienza molto giovane, molto incerta, perché uno dei problemi principali della bibliometria è che i dati bibliometrici sono prevalentemente chiusi, nel senso che sono posseduti da Clarivate Analytics, l'ex ISIT, che c'è addirittura soltanto un gruppo di ricerca, che è quello di Leiden, che può permettersi il lusso, perché si pagano, di accedere ai raw data. Quindi che una vera e propria comunità scientifica che fa dibattiti pubblici sulla bibliometria non c'è affatto. Quindi il risultato qual è? Il risultato è appunto una scienza che è in crisi perché non ha gli strumenti per controllare se stessa da una parte, appunto usa strumenti artigianali e inadeguati, perché è sotto pressione da parte di una serie di interessi extra scientifici e perché gli strumenti burocratici che vengono usati per la valutazione sono in realtà offerti da una scienza molto giovane, molto incerta. Infatti molti valutatori usano quella che viene chiamata amateur bibliometric, bibliometria fai da te. Adesso, aprire il dibattito, la mostra Retraction Watch, perfino nella situazione attuale, aprire il dibattito offre qualche correttivo. Adesso, i correttivi ovviamente non saranno mai i correttivi che riusciranno a risolvere il problema. C'è un bel libro scritto da Enrico Bucci, Cattivi Scienziati, che parla appunto del problema della frode della scienza e dice: quando è che questi signori vengono scoperti? Beh, se uno è sufficientemente furbo da produrre una ricerca che non ha applicazioni industriali, è abbastanza facile che non venga mai scoperto, perché quando è che i falsificatori vengono scoperti? Beh, quando ci sono delle applicazioni industriali, quando ci sono delle possibili applicazioni industriali, quindi gli applicatori chiedono informazioni al ricercatore e poi si scopre che il ricercatore si è inventato i suoi dati oppure li ha resi più sexy. Ecco, quindi de-enfatizzare l'articolo, la produzione, eccetera, è certamente un possibile rimedio che richiede anche un cambio di cultura e una profonda revisione del senso della scienza, cioè solo quello industriale, solo quello al servizio di interessi forti che stanno fuori della scienza o è anche qualcos'altro. Ecco, però, d'altra parte però bisogna anche dire che la scienza, nel momento in cui pretende di essere una intrapresa che non tratta nessun problema per risolto, perché trattare i problemi per risolti significa essere scientisti e credenti e non scienziati, deve anche fare i conti con un margine di incertezza, cioè deve essere consapevole che quello che adesso è teoria assodata, che ne so, la teoria cosmologica di Tolomeo, domani può diventare un'ipotesi da discutere e domani l'altro può diventare un'ipotesi superata. Quindi sì, il problema è molto sfaccettato ed è molto complesso, e adesso perché ho parlato solo della questione visione paritaria, individuo, eccetera, eccetera, perché appunto io mi sono concentrata su un elemento artigianale che ahimè sopravvive nel bene e anche nel male nel sistema di selezione, di valutazione della scienza. Però c'è questa dimensione industriale che è estremamente complessa e che appunto crea, complica i nostri problemi. Però la cosa interessante da ricordare, questa è l'ultima cosa che vi dico, è che Galileo Galilei pubblicò il suo Sidereus Nuncius a stampa per un piccolo tipografo veneziano, e questo gesto di pubblicazione fu un gesto di rottura, perché la ricerca usava essere segreta. Invece cosa fece Galileo Galilei? Beh, fece il corrispondente di quello che farebbe oggi uno scienziato, che dicesse: metto tutto in rete alla maniera di Timothy Gowers, anziché aspettare di pubblicarlo nel Top Journal. Forse avete visto un recentissimo video fatto dalla Nobel Foundation, qui ci sono ben 12 premi Nobel, che dicono di non trattare la ricerca come una collezione di articoli che hanno valore nella misura in cui sono pubblicati qui e non là, ma considerare valutare la ricerca per quello che questi testi dicono. Quindi, diciamo, questa questione è una questione che sì, è una questione che ancora un po' da anticonformisti proporre, però appunto non siamo più gli unici a dire che abbiamo di fronte un problema serio e un problema che va affrontato, perché poi il nostro Richard Horton è il direttore di una rivista medica, quindi questo, quando si parla di metà dei risultati degli articoli scientifici falsi, si sta parlando di cure per il cancro, si sta parlando di cure cardiologiche, quindi mi piacerebbe fare una chemioterapia sapendo che forse funzionerà, ma forse anche no, perché le pubblicazioni scientifiche in peer review journals che la certificano forse non sono così solide come dicono di essere. Quindi un problema che è anche socialmente serio, cioè a me come paziente piacerebbe affrontare la mia chemioterapia sapendo che è stata testata e sperimentata seriamente.
Bene, grazie ancora. Sono 10 minuti di intervallo prima della lezione dell'avvocato.